All right, continuing along, chapter 14, oscillators, phase lock loop, and tone decoder. We're going to really dig into the different types of oscillators, and it's going to be easier than you think because it's fairly easy to recognize certain things. The first two is going to be the Colpitts and the Hartley. And I have to warn you up front, sometimes I know it says Hartley. There have been times I accidentally called it the Harley. And you know I've got motorcycles on the mind when I say that. Anyway, the Hartley, the Colpitts. Now, if we compare the two back and forth, the Hartley, think H, we have two inductors in series. The Colpitts, C is for capacitor. We have two capacitors in series like this. So that's kind of a quick and easy way. Now, if you notice, the difference between the two circuits is the inductors and the capacitor change places with capacitors and inductors. So they're really kind of almost the same circuit, just flipped upside down. Everything else remains about the same. And the idea here is you want something that is sending energy from this point to this point to this point to this point. That's the whole idea of these oscillators. And so they work about the same way. So these two capacitors or two inductors, in the case of the Colpitts, let's talk about that. They create a 180 degree phase shift. And of course, the transistor itself acts as 180 degrees. So between this 180 degree and these guys doing 180 degree, you've got a full 360 and positive feedback. So both of these guys take advantage of the resonant frequency found between capacitors and inductors. Colpitts, single inductor, two capacitors, C for capacitor. Hartley, single capacitor, two inductors. Okay, now I included the formula for the Colpitts as well as the Hartley, and I am not going to make you memorize the formula or even ask you on a test. I suppose if you bang around on a calculator, you can figure it out. But I have a hard time thinking that as technicians, you'll ever use these particular formulas. So I may be wrong. Maybe somebody works in an RF company and they have to calculate all this stuff all the time. But you'll learn then. But obviously, the Colpitts is a little more complicated than the Hartley. But such as it is. Now, if you wanted to vary the frequency of the oscillator, the Colpitts is probably the best choice because you can vary the value of the inductor, which is probably a lot easier than trying to vary a value of a capacitor. We have limited range here, a lot more option with Colpitts. Now, in some of the Hartley circuits, notice you see two inductors. Well, what if we had a single inductor with a center tap? Okay, well, voila, here it is. Now, unfortunately, this is a bipolar junction transistor, and this is a MOSFET. So, not a MOSFET, a JFET. God, forgive me. You can tell I'm off. Anyway, JFET. But the same idea holds true is that we have a center tapped inductor that's giving this phase shift. It is possible to make the Hartley oscillator with an op amp. Of course, the upper frequency is going to be limited by the range of this guy. Notice we have a single capacitor, two inductors, still makes it a Hartley. Okay, why would I choose one over the other? So let's talk about why I'd pick the Hartley. Okay, The frequency can be adjusted using a single variable capacitor, one side which can be grounded. So that's a good idea. The output amplitude remains constant over the frequency range. Well, that's good. We need something like that. Say we're building an RF oscillator and we want to vary it. A tapped coil or two fixed inductors are needed. But check this out. There are very few other components. Now, it's also easy to create an accurate fixed frequency crystal oscillator variation by replacing the capacitor with a parallel resonant quartz crystal, or replacing the top half of the tank circuit with a crystal and a grid leak resistor. So in a nutshell, we could put a crystal here, or you could put it here, for example. Those are examples of what you could do. Now, what are the disadvantages? Well, unfortunately, you're going to get a very harmonic-rich output is going to be taken from the amplifier. And you don't want to take it directly from the LC circuit unless you have some sort of amplitude stabilization, negative feedback to keep the amplitude from going a little crazy. That's about it. Okay, now you'll notice I didn't mention any advantages of coal pits. Off the top of my head, I forgot them. So don't worry, I'm not going to ask you. Okay, another oscillator. We're now to page 5. Come on, there we go. The clap oscillator. Oh, forgive me. But all I can think of when I do this is clap on, clap off. Not intended to be that way. It sure looks like a variation of the coal pits because you see the two capacitors in series. Okay. But really the meat of it is between this inductor and capacitor as the energy kind of bounces back and forth. The frequency calculation, and you can all go, thank God I don't have to deal with this. There it is. Okay. So there's a number of different choices. Because you're not in engineering class, you don't have to worry about the trade-offs here. Wien bridge oscillator. Now, I just couldn't resist showing this particular circuit, and I'll explain that in a moment. But the interesting thing about this particular oscillator is that's a light bulb. Now you're going, who in the world would put a light bulb in an oscillator circuit? Actually, HP did. One of the older HP oscillators we have has an actual light bulb hidden inside the cabinet. And you're all going, what? Why? Well, because as more current goes through the filament of the bulb, the resistance of the bulb goes up. We have a very elegant and very simple negative feedback circuit, taking advantage of a physical characteristic of a light bulb. Because one of the problems with the Wien bridge oscillator, if you want to get a nice clean sine wave, you can't have too much feedback. Because otherwise you'll just clip in the top and bottom of the sine wave. So anyway, basically these are the equations. I wouldn't worry too much about them. Usually R equals R1, which is equal to R2, C equals C1, C2, and so on. RB, where is it? Somewhere, is used to control gain. I think I meant to say RF because I don't see it there. I'm sorry. Here's RB is the one that controls the gain. Okay, so you want to know what the calculations for the circuit are. There you have it. You won't be asked on this. Okay, so That's the old style oscillator. Modern Wien bridge oscillators used other nonlinear elements such as diodes, thermistor, field effect transistors for amplitude stabilization in place of a light bulb. So let's take a look at this particular circuit here. See the diodes back to back? So if the amplitude is low, it goes through the 10K ohm. But as the amplitude gets higher, progressively higher, now it's going to jump across the diodes. And so that's going to act as a negative feedback to kind of lower the amp. You don't want this thing going too high because you'll chop the bottom and top of a sine wave. So the Wien bridge has to have a negative feedback circuit, be it a light bulb or diodes or whatever, to avoid clipping the sine wave. So anyway, between these two sections, Z1 and Z2, it's trying to find the balance point. And that's really why it works. Now, it is possible to build a Wien bridge oscillator with a manual gain control. As we see here, you can sit there and adjust the pot and try to find that sweet spot where it'll oscillate just fine. Can be done. Okay, normally we don't find this manual thing. People would rather have an automatic, sorry, I'm losing my voice, automatic gain control. Okay, last thing we're going to talk about, and this has been one of my favorites when I was going to college. I fell in love with these devices. The phase lock loop. Okay, when I first heard about it, my reaction was, why? But as I began to use it and work with it, I understood exactly why this device was such a wonderful device. So we have an input signal and a phase detector, which is comparing the output of our voltage-controlled oscillator to our input signal. We have a filter, kind of a low-pass filter, because you don't want to have all these sudden little on-offs, on-offs going through to the correction voltage. Just smooths it all out. So that's the voltage that will cause this to increase or decrease in frequency. And the bottom line is, whatever input frequency we get here, we should get the exact same frequency output. So in other words, here's the here's our input frequency. Our voltage controlled oscillator, our phase lock loop, is going to try to lock into that incoming frequency. Now, if this goes up, this guy will go up. If this goes down, this guy will go down. Now, at first thought, you're going, why? Why don't we just grab the input signal and, you know, then it matches every time? But a phase lock loop, it's not so much we care about having a matched output here. What we're interested in is this correction voltage. Because think about it, as the frequency goes up, the correction voltage changes. Okay. So what happens is, between our input, and it's drawn nicely here with the square wave, we have a slight time delay, which creates like a little voltage pulse. And so there's our correction voltage. And of course, if we filter that out, that'll even out to a nice line. And the more phase shift, the more voltage, the higher in frequency it'll get, it'll kind of naturally follow a certain phase. But what'll happen as we increase the frequency, this will start to collapse, the voltage is too low, it, you know, it'll adjust downward to fix it. So it's going to try to match that incoming frequency. So even if you don't follow this diagram, the important thing is the voltage controlled oscillator has a correction voltage that is going to change to match the incoming frequency. And it'll be very, very accurate. Okay. There is a slight time delay or phase shift between input versus output, but we don't worry about that. And by the way, the loop filter, which I described over here, that just filters out the pulses into a nice, clean, smooth voltage, because we don't want to It's kind of like you don't drive your car down the street on the gas pedal, boom, 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 like that. You have a nice even pressure on it. The VCO doesn't want to see boom, boom, boom. It wants to see a fairly constant voltage. So for a little higher in frequency, the gap shortens, the control voltage changes, and that'll change the VCO's frequency. If we're too low in frequency, then the gap grows wider, resulting in an increase in the correction voltage, increasing the VCO's frequency. The bottom line, what you need to take away, is that the voltage-controlled oscillator here will try to follow the input frequency. It may be slightly shifted in phase compared to this input signal, but if you put a frequency counter here and here, you're going to see the exact same frequency. And again, the part we're interested in is not that output, but the correction voltage. All right, so let's talk about an application where the VCO really shines. So we have an input to an FM signal that contains audio. With FM, if this is the carrier frequency, as the waveform goes up and down, the carrier frequency increases and decreases. The intelligence of FM is not found in the amplitude, that's AM, but in the carrier frequency shift above and below the normal silent frequency. Well, would that change? How do we see it? Remember, the correction voltage reacts to the change. So suddenly, if you know this is going up, the correction voltage is going to change. If this is going down, the correction voltage changes. And it's a very linear relationship. So, and the beauty of the phase lock loop with FM decoding is, if there's a bunch of noise spikes here, this gets all filtered out. So we never see it on the correction voltage. You have a lot of noise on this end, and you just hear the clean signal as it kind of averages everything out. Okay, so all the various spikes and signal dropouts, they're gone. So it has almost no impact on audio. And any noise that's outside of the phase lock's loop range is ignored. So, bottom line, extreme noise immunity. It's just ideal and probably the number one choice for an FM demodulator. Now, I have to say the phase lock loop goes all the way back to somewhere in the 1930s. However, building a phase lock loop with vacuum tubes is a lesson in frustration. It took a lot of vacuum tubes. And if you're trying to sell FM radios, for example, you don't want to add to the cost of the device. So we'll look at cheaper ways of building it. However, and of course, in the 60s, you could have built it with transistors and stuff. It's still kind of pricey for an FM radio. We get into the 1970s, and hey, lo and behold, here's a chip that can do it all. And suddenly the phase lock loop IC becomes very, very practical and affordable circuit. Okay, that concludes page 6 and this week's lecture. Next week, we continue on page 7 and onward. I will come back a little bit more on the, I'll tell you what, let's cover it while we're here. Here's a carrier, here's a modulating wave. Okay, as the frequency, or as the voltage is down, the frequency is lower. As the voltage goes up, the frequency is higher. This is what an FM signal looks like. Okay, so I'm not going to cover that for next week. We'll go on to look specifically at the 565 phase lock loop. But I thought I might show you that just so you had some idea about FM modulation. I had to squeeze that in there. Okay, so that pretty much is it. Let me go over and have a good week and take care.